Praise the Lord. Let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. Well, good to see you. Turn to your neighbor and say, good to see you. Welcome to Bethel Assembly. And we trust that those of you that are visiting with us for the first time, that you will feel at home here. And you will enjoy the service. For those that are watching online, God bless you. And we know that you will, every now and again, our computer operator will put the church phone number on the screen, so you'll be able to see how to contact us if you so desire, if you have questions. Dawn's coming, but before she does, I'm just going to have a word of prayer with you. Thank you, Father, for this house, for this place and this space. Thank you for your presence, for in your presence there is fullness of joy. And in your right hand there are so much goodness that flows from you. We thank you, Lord, that in you we live and move and have our being. I ask, Lord, that for each one that is listening to the sound of my voice right now, whether it's online or in this house, we ask, Lord, that you'd open their ears, you'd open their eyes. They will see and feel your love, and they will respond to your love, and that you will soften their hearts so that with their hearts they will be able to make decisions, Lord, regarding their life, that they will get to know you and have a relationship with you. In Jesus' mighty name, we thank you. Amen.
Isn't it great to be here this morning? It's wonderful. It's sun shining out, and oh, it's hard to stay inside when it's like this, but I'm glad to be inside church this morning. I guess one or two announcements. Please, if you don't have your calendar, please make sure to pick it up. It's out at the info desk, and it's there for you. It's got all of our information for the weeks ahead. One thing that is not on the calendar is Loaves and Fishes Cook Day, which will be happening this Friday, the 19th, and it starts at 9 and ends when we get done, basically. So at Loaves and Fishes, we have a saying on our cook day, come when you can, leave when you must. So if you say, well, I can't get there until 11, come at 11. If I have to leave at 1, leave at 1. It doesn't matter. Step in, help us out for a little while. It's always a good time, right, Linda? It's a good time. We have a great time. So please just mark that down. That's the 19th. Well, it's Mission Sunday. Woo! What'd you say, Pastor Ron? The girls won last month? They did. They did.
Uh-oh.
I'm in trouble.
I just want to say something about that. Because I hear that the girls won last time. Well, I have to tell you, this morning I watched a gentleman put an offering in the women's bucket. I saw it with mine own eyes. I will not tell you who that was. But I'll tell you, that's what kind of competition is all about. The men are helping the women. So we don't know how many men helped out the women last time. Just
can
saying.
Can I say something?
No. No.
Amber told Brandon that she'd whoop him if he didn't put it in the girls. So he didn't have much choice. Sorry, Brandon.
Well, my wife, she had her little jar there, and I'm sitting there, and it was right on the table, ready for her to pick up, and I'm going, okay, my money is not going in that jar. You know, and it's okay to have fun in the house of the Lord.
Amen.
And, you know, yes, it's a little bit of competition, but I really am glad for everyone that participates in raising them, putting their little extra money in for our missionaries. We have a couple of them, and the one we're going to be able to see in June. They're going to be with us in June, and probably Don will tell you all about that. But I was just so excited to see a gentleman put his offering in the women's.
So it is a lot of fun, but the bottom line is that last month we raised $260.45 for missions, and that is awesome. And I want to read a little bit of our rights update, and I'm telling you, all foolishness aside, this was an amazing one. When Pastor Ron handed me this and I read it, I thought, I can't read the whole thing, but boy, oh boy, I wish I could. So the rights, like some of you may or may not know, are in a restricted access nation, and there are missionaries, and they will be coming home in June, and I wrote it down, Pastor Ron just said it, June 19th. They will be here at Bethel. That's a Wednesday night. They will be here at Bethel, and it will be a combined service with us and Heartland, and so they're going to share. So make sure you mark that on your calendar. Make sure you're here to support them. So the rights update this month had a lot in it, and this one, I'm just going to skim through it, but it says one heading, so what have we been up to? And it says, I need to start by saying thank you to all those who have prayed for these services. We had an amazing 3 days packed with 12 services, followed by a service project to a local learning center for refugees. We came out of that week totally exhausted, but thoroughly amazed about God's goodness. Now this next part is amazing, and it says, where God is welcome, expect the unexpected. Woohoo, here we go. And it says, on Tuesday night during the prayer time, a young man came up to me and asked for prayer. He was born with a right arm that doesn't work and is shorter than the other one, and had wanted to know if I could pray for his arm to grow. Someone had told him that God would heal his shriveled arm. And I'd honestly never prayed for a shriveled arm before, but of course I couldn't tell him that, so I did my best to pray in faith for God to do what he alone could do. On Wednesday night, he found me again after the service, the same young man. And I assumed that he'd come to me to try again, but he had actually come to show me that his arm had grown. And it goes on, Bob says, I was more surprised actually than he was. But he told me that it was now the exact same size as the other one, but it was still weak. So I said, well, pray again. And because we should pray that, because what else do you do to tell a young man who has just told you that God had made his arm longer overnight? So I prayed once again, and he smiled and thanked me and left. And now there goes on to another testimony, very similar, about praying for a young man again, and his arm grew, and he said he asked us to pray for both these young men, that they would receive Reuben in their arms, both of them. So that is amazing. It also mentions that they are running an Alpha program. We all know about Alpha. And that they're using that to reach out to people to teach them English. And so we're going to pray for Bob and Nancy and keep them in your prayers continually as they travel. Local missions, an update. Last month we took up donations for our food bank. Shannon delivered 280 pounds of groceries to the food bank. That was amazing. And I just want to mention this. At the info desk, there's something for Open Door Ministries. It's a prayer calendar. It's for April. And so it just gives you something to pray for every day. If you'd like one, please come and pick it up. And so today, Sunday the 14th, is actually a prayer for Nigeria, which Izu is here, and he's from Nigeria. And it says, today marks 10 years since 276 girls were kidnapped from their school. Pray for the grieving parents of the estimated 112 women who are still missing. So, as a parent to two girls, that killed me. I know where my girls are, and I'm thankful for that. But your heart breaks for those that don't. So let's pray for those women, those moms and dads that are missing their girls. And let's pray for our missionaries. Then we're going to take up our missionary offering. Lord, we just come to you and we thank you thank you for this opportunity to give towards these wonderful missions to this beautiful people that serve you in another country. They risk their lives. They've left their families to come and serve you. And Lord, we just pray a blessing, a great blessing upon them and all that they do, Lord. And we pray specifically for these two young men. Lord, I pray complete healing in their arms. Complete and utter healing in their arm. Lord, we speak your name, of the name of Jesus, into that arm. Lord, that you would begin to heal it and they would begin to move. Lord, and that they would become testimonies to their families and to their neighbors, that they could show them that this is what the one true God does. And Lord, we pray for Nigeria, the country of Nigeria, and for those moms and dads and families that have lost daughters. And Lord, our heart breaks. And I pray that you would comfort them. And Lord, comfort those women and bring them home, we pray, in Jesus' name. Lord, we thank you for your goodness and your mercy upon us and all that you've done. Thank you for blessing us so that we can bless others. We just praise you and give you honor in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to ask you to bring your offering. Drop your money. Take your box. I have extra boxes at the info desk. Bring it up and drop it off. And let's see how much the girls whooped the boys this month. Thank you, everyone. We are so blessed to have a wonderful family, Robert Tanika Chambers, here. And it's been wonderful to get to know them, and they have such a heart for ministry. Tanika they've left Ontario. They came here and not knowing, I don't know, Carleton County, New Brunswick? I don't know. What were you thinking? But God led you here, and he's led you into a ministry that's going to be starting the 27th, I believe, it's going to be opening up, and I want Tanika to come and share with you about her new ministry and what God's doing. It's just amazing.
Good morning, Bethel. Good morning. Good morning. Moving from a community in Ontario that was culturally diverse to then moving to Woodstock, New Brunswick, it was a big change for my family and I. But we followed God's leading and we're happy that we did. You can never go wrong when God leads you to do something. There's always a purpose and a reason bigger than what you know. While we knew that things would not be the same, I did not expect to experience what I did this past November. I accepted a job position, and unfortunately, I dealt with some discrimination. This could have been very traumatic for me. But instead, it fueled my passion to create positive change wherever I go. And although that was a negative experience, it led me to create Exhale. Could you take a deep breath with me? This is how it feels at times as newcomers when we go through different experiences and have no one really a safe space to share it. So it led me to create Excel for Black Wellbeing under my nonprofit organization, GAMP. Is GAMP up? You guys have the image? Is it there? Yeah, there you go. GAMP, which means giving hope and minding people. There's a quote by the well-known American poet Maya Angelou that says, "The ache for home aches in all of us, the safe place where we can go as we are and not be questioned." The Multicultural Association here in Woodstock delivers services that connect new immigrants to their community. My program is unique in that we focus on the well-being of Black newcomers as well as Black families living within Carlton County. Exhale is going to further help to increase Black newcomers' sense of belonging, improve self-confidence and self-esteem amongst Black children and youth who experience racial discrimination, reduce feelings of isolation so that Black families will stay here and not feel that they need to move away due to a lack of community. It will provide a safe space for sharing and receiving support and more. Who are we not? Exhale, GAMP, is not an angry, aggressive group of Black individuals pointing the finger at the wrongs of another race, but our desire is to bring understanding because culture is missing here. More about Exhale will be shared at our upcoming launch right here in Woodstock. It will actually be next door. Am I pointing the right, over there? At 115 St. James Street, because of the building's Black history as the first African Methodist Episcopal Church in Woodstock, we felt what better place to launch and hold such a program. Mind you, when we came here, we had no idea, none. So on Saturday, April 27, 2024, we will launch GAMP and the Exhale program into the community. In our short time here, we've had the pleasure of sharing some of our ideas and initiatives of which Carlton County has been receptive. So on February 3rd and 10th, GAMP held its first educational program at the L.P. Fisher Library to educate children and youth about Black history. And the response from parents from all backgrounds and races, as well as the library staff alike, their feedback was very positive. We then had the opportunity to share at Woodstock High, and students are still talking about the presentation that we did there, which is so good. We plan to host more community events where all are welcome to participate because this helps all of our well-being. In January 2024, after my lived experience and feeling God, you know, moving it upon me to do something, I then did a survey. So in January 2024, I conducted a survey to gain a better understanding on how Black newcomers and Black longtime residents, how they felt about their integration and experience living in Carlton County. And 80% responded having experienced some form of racism, racial slurs, treated unfairly because of their Blackness, to name a few. This was common within places of work, elementary, high school, and in the community while doing their day-to-day errands. This survey also revealed an urgent need for emotional, social, and advocacy support for Black children and youth and their parents in Carlton County. And parents with mixed-race children were also part of this survey. One parent wrote, "The biggest change we face as a family are weight bared on our two eldest children. They are experiencing name calling and racial slurs most days, if not daily. Even by pairs they have become friendly with, if there's an argument or a disagreement, the kids go directly to attack their race and color of their skin. Their father also experiences some push, although not direct verbal racism, but he can feel very much that he is not welcomed by those around him and is treated with some coldness." And another comment from a surveyor said, "It's hard to thrive if you are in Carlton County as a Black person." This is not reflective of every Black person here in Carlton County, but a majority have experienced a form of discrimination. Black children who live in predominantly white communities known as Eurocentric environments often face unique challenges that can profoundly affect both their and their parents' well-being. The impact of these challenges can extend from the school playground to the community at large, like we just heard from one parent. Outside of school, Black children and their families may experience a lack of cultural understanding and acceptance in their communities. And the absence of social support coupled with racial discrimination can lead to feelings of isolation, anxiety, stress. Parents of Black children in predominantly white towns often bear the emotional burden of these challenges. They find themselves constantly navigating conversations about race, advocating for their children in school, and dealing with their own experiences of racial bias. This can lead to increased stress and a diminishing, again, of well-being. Scripture teaches us to carry each other's burdens, because in this way, we will fulfill the law of Christ. That's Galatians 6:2. Understanding these challenges, Exhale for Black Well-Being is stepping into doing just that. And through our work, we strive to create a world where Black children and all races can thrive together, regardless of where they live. So once again, we will be launching this program on Saturday, April 27th at 6 p.m. next door. It will be a $30 ticketed event with proceeds going towards running the program. The $30, as I said, is ticketed. If you're on hard times, you can't afford it, you really want to come, just show up. I'll put that out there. If you have any questions at all about what I just shared, feel free to approach me after service. I'll be more than welcome to answer any questions that you have. So I just want to thank Pastor Ron and, there he is, Pastor Ron and Pastor Shannon for allowing this mission in Carleton County. Thank you.
Praise the Lord. Oh, come on, you can do better than that. Come on, come on. This is a God thing. This is a God thing. This is what God does. There's no black or white, there's no male or female, no Jew, no Gentile in Christ. In Christ, we're one. And we just want to bless Tanika and what she is endeavoring that God has given her. And Father, we thank you and praise you for this work that you are leading her into. And we pray, Father, that you would bless those that have been hurting and suffering, those who have been separated, God, in one way or another. And we pray, God, that you would minister to them. And we bless her in this, in Jesus' name. Thank you for the heritage in this community that you want to thrive and to grow again and to make well. And we thank you for this in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
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 Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Tanika. I brought this box because I felt that I needed to pray over our offering. Sometimes I don't do that. I used to always, it's like salting the sacrifice in the Old Testament. And I just want to thank you for your continued support and giving to our various causes and but our tithes and our offerings. You know, our tithes are 10% of what God has given each of us. And offerings are over and above. When we give to missions and give to the different things, the offering, that's an offering. It's over and above, usually our tithes. And after I'm done praying, if someone can grab hold of this and put it back on the table for me, I would appreciate that. Heavenly Father, I thank you for the offering that has been received. Some will put their tithes and offerings into this box later. We thank you for the offering that has been received for our missions giving. You are so good, and we bless your wonderful name. You give. You give. You give. And you ask, well, what a deal. You only ask for 10%. But actually, God, we owe you everything. We owe you our lives, and we just want to say thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you, Colin.
Can we stand if you're able? And let's worship the Lord. Thank you, Father.
Oh, Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe display. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. From lofty mountain grandeur, and hear the brook, and feel the gentle breeze. My soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God his Son not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in that on the cross my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. And my soul, my Savior God, to me. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art.
A clap offering to our great God.
Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend. Who would have thought that a Lamb could rescue the souls of man? Oh, rescue the souls of man. You are the one that we praise. Oh, you are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace.
Never end your
You know, when we pray and we ask the Lord for things, it's because of His mercy and His grace. God the Father, He provided a place and a space where you can receive help. You can receive a touch in your body. And if you have a need today, we have folks that have their tags, and be delighted to stand out in the aisles and pray for you. It's all because of His mercy. It's all because of His grace that we can come to You, Lord. We can come to You. We can come to You. We can come to You, Lord. Redeemer, Your Savior, You're our healer and friend. Every day, renew my faith, fill me with love that never ends. Strength when I am weak, You are the pleasure treasure that I see. You are my all in all. Seeking You as a precious jewel, Lord, to give up I'd be a fool. You are my all. My strength when I am weak. You are the treasure that I see. You are my all in all. Seeking You as a precious jewel, or to give up I'd be a fool. You are my all in all.
yours, and again I bless your name. You are my all in all. When I fall down, you pick me up. When I am dry, you fill my cup. You are my all in all. Oh, Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Your name,
Jesus.
Praise you, Lord. Praise you, Lord. Worthy, 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 worthy.
Jesus. Father, I thank you for your presence in this place. I thank you, Lord, for our children. And I thank you, Lord, for their teacher. Instruct them today in Jesus' name. And now as we turn our attention to your word, Lord, thank you that it is a light to us, pathway. There was a group of tourists that visited a crocodile farm, and the owner of the place launched a daring proposal to those that came. Whoever dares to jump, swim to shore, and survive, I will give them $1 million. And nobody dared to move. Suddenly, a man jumped into the water and desperately swam towards the shore, all the while he was being chased by the crocodiles. With great luck, he arrived, taking the admiration of everyone in the place. Then the owner announced, "We have a brave winner." After collecting his reward, the couple returned to the hotel upon arrival, and the manager says to the man, "I heard you made a very brave jump." Then the man said, "I didn't jump. Somebody pushed me." All the while in the background, his wife was smiling. Behind every successful man, there is a woman who pushes him. I think everybody needs somebody to push them once in a while. After telling this story, on the other hand, how many have been hurt in some way? Perhaps somebody pushed you. You didn't want to be pushed. Somebody hurt you. Maybe it was a parent, a sibling, a relative, friends, a fellow worker, teachers. Jesus said, offenses will come. I don't think he ever said somebody will push you into a crocodile swamp. But he said, offenses will come, and he did say, tribulations will come. And I want to tell you this morning that the enemy, I'm talking about Satan, wants to define you by your scars. But Jesus wants to define you by his scars. Okay, that went over good. If you don't mind, I'll just have a little talk with myself. We it's true. We walk around sometimes bearing our scars. We want to show our scars to everybody because we figure that our scars is that which defines us. And when you recognize what Jesus has done for us, your scars no longer define you, but who it was that gave his life for you. Jesus wants to define you by his scars. The Lord Jesus has already defeated our enemy, hands down. Glory to God. However, by the way, we've been dealing with Ephesians, the book of Ephesians. We had part one last week. And if you want to know what we preached on, you just read Ephesians chapter 1. We gave it to you as homework, as well as Ephesians chapter 2 for this week. Next week, we'll look at Ephesians chapter 4. The following week, we'll look at Ephesians chapter 5. We'll continue till Ephesians chapter 6 is done. So I'm not going to take the time to read Ephesians chapter 2, just like we didn't read it last week. I the book of Ephesians, like I said, it serves as a manual for, it's like believer's boot camp. The Lord said, did I tell you that the Lord defeated the devil hands down? However, the Lord has left it up to us to enforce in the trenches of everyday life the victory he has won for us through his death and resurrection. The book of Ephesians was teachings that was meant to teach the church and equip the church to help them understand the vast spiritual weaponry and armor that is ours in order to accomplish and see the victory in the physical realm. Victory is ours if we stand against the schemes and the plights of the devil. And the book of Ephesians is serious training for serious believers. The blessings of God are a finished work. We already possess them. Many don't know it. If you've accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, all the things that I will talk about are yours. If you have not accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and personal Savior, you can receive Christ as your Savior today, whether you're here in this room or watching online. The blessings of God are a finished work. They've already been paid for. We've taken a lot of time. Last month, we talked about what Jesus accomplished for us on the cross of Calvary. And If you want to find out what all that was about, go online, Facebook, or you can search it out through our website, and you'll find out what Jesus did for us on the cross of Calvary. I'm trying to teach you these during these sessions each week what we have been given in Christ Jesus. And he's already provided them. But you have to fight for it. Just like Joshua had to fight for the promised land. God told Joshua, he told Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, he promised them and gave them a promised land. But do you know Joshua, and he was led to go in to the promised land, and he had to get it. He had to possess it. We can get all happy that God made the promise, but if you want the promise, sometimes you have to go after it. The devil is intimidated by your presence. Do you realize that? He's intimidated because of your future destiny. God has predestined for us great things. And it stems from a fixed fight. Turn to your neighbor and say, it's a fixed fight. It's a fixed fight, praise God. Nothing the enemy does can ever abort what God has already done unless you let it. Think about your eternal position being united in Christ. It was wonderful to experience the water baptism services from last week. We watched people go into the water. They identified with Christ. By the way, if you haven't been water baptized and you've given your life to Jesus, you haven't been water baptized, talk to Don or Shannon or myself and say, you know, Pastor, I'd like that. The enemy wants to define you by your scars. But Jesus wants to define you by his. So in baptism, we identify with Christ. The cross and the resurrection of Christ is to us as the crossing of the Red Sea was to Israel. It was your point of reference for God's power in our lives, because death is the greatest enemy we have to confront. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1. I'm going to use the New King James Version for you. And it says, and you hath ye quickened, who were dead in trespasses in sin. And Paul the Apostle, he lumps us all together. And he says, and you. Turn to your neighbor and says, he's talking to you. To you has he quickened. You who were dead in trespasses and sin, and you have the same resurrection power in you. The power that raised Christ from the dead, he tells us, it's in you. You have it all. He has quickened you. He's made alive you. From the moment we were born in this world, we have a built-in desire to run with the world around us so that it benefits and serves us. We are all born with a self-centeredness. We are all born with a me-first identity. We feel like that the world revolves around us. That is the very essence of the sin nature. But God's purpose for our lives is that we would have God-first identity. And this identity goes against our pride and the pride of the world. Matthew 6:33 says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Whatever you want God to bless, whatever you want God to bless, put him first in that area. I remember we had a board member in our church, my very first church years ago, back in 1980. And that was his. He wanted to give, actually, he wanted a tennis court. He was very athletic, wanted a tennis court. And there, of course, back then, there were a lot of money. And he purposed in his heart, if I want a tennis court, I'm going to give God that amount of money first. That's what he did. He had God first. And by the way, he did build that tennis court. What causes us to leave God's plan for our lives and follow our own plan? Well, we have a very low tolerance for delayed gratification. We think we can do it faster, we can do it better than God. And I have to tell you, that's just human pride. But this scripture in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1, and you has he quickened. In you has he quickened, who were dead in trespasses and sins. We were dead. And in that scripture where it says you were dead, that means you were separated from God. You know, the interesting thing, God told Adam, he says, in the day that you eat the fruit, in the day that you eat thereof, you shall surely die. That wasn't physical death. But it was death, separation from God. Whenever you are separated from God, you're dead. Just as your body was separated from your spirit, it cannot function on earth. Your spirit, separation from God's spirit, and being separated from God, it's hard to function. It cannot function. Body, spirit cannot function being separate from God. Physical death silences the body, but spiritual death silences the spirit. We're walking around, but we're dead. Separated from God. That's what we were. Ephesians 2:2 says, where in times past you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince and the power of the air, the spirit that now works in the children of disobedience. Because we were dead, we tried everything possible to make ourselves feel alive. People do all kinds of things to make themselves feel alive. That's basically where sin comes from. And there's a little nagging voice in each of us before we knew God. You're still empty. You're still empty. You're still empty. You're empty because you don't know God. Now that word according, great term. We talked about that last week. You know, when I played a chord on the piano, a chord sounds real nice. A chord is in harmony. You know, and so that root word, that according, is that word chord. In harmony with one's pleasure, purpose, and power. And I said, you'll find that word according all throughout the book of Ephesians. According to what here? In this particular verse, according to what? You, in times past, you walked according or in a harmony to the course of this world, to the prince and power of the air. That's what we were in harmony with. Wow. Separate from God. The atmosphere where human beings live, we were subject to that harmony. Wow. We were subject to the disobedience, which means that we were totally non-compliant. In the Old Testament, they used to call that stiff-necked. Before you knew God, you were stiff-necked. Among verse 3, among those whom also we had conversations in times past, in the lust of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature children of wrath.
Wow.
That's what we were. We were warring, we were planning against all that is holy by serving the God of self, fulfilling every carnal desire and inclination. It was the way we were before salvation. And let me tell you, it was ugly. Satan was supernaturally powerful and much smarter than we were. But before salvation, we took hook, line, and sinker his lies. The world system around us, or the world system surrounded us from birth. And we were imprisoned in our carnal sin nature. Yet somehow we managed to escape. Somehow we managed to escape. That's how we come to be here. How in the world did we come to be here? In verse 4 it says, but God, who is rich in mercy, glory to God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us. There was no other solution but God to help us out of the mess. Verse 5, even when we were dead in sins, he's quickened us together. That's what God did by dying on the cross and rising from the dead. We were born dead, but God through Christ quickened us. Somebody say, praise the Lord. This is big. Deliverance. Now, you know, using this as an illustration, you can think of UPS or FedEx. Happens not just when somebody sends a package, but when somebody else receives that package. We've got to reach out and take hold, just like the package we receive from UPS or FedEx or Canada Post. We've got to reach out and receive it. We take hold of the salvation and blessings God provided. When people become Christians, one of the hardest things to do is to retrain them not to continue to operate according or in harmony with the world system. It took one night to get Israel out of Egypt, but it took them 40 years of wandering in the wilderness. And then they still had to go into the land. They had to get Egypt out of them, 40 years. And then they still had to march in and take the promised land. Well, we wonder why not everybody's perfect when we come to church. We were subject to the system of the world. It takes time to get that world out of us. There's always a battle between the new man and the old man. And that's why we need teaching like the Apostle Paul gives to the Ephesians. We're not dead anymore. So don't act like it. We can protest all we want, but you can't legislate morality in Canada. You can't get unregenerated people to live like saints. In fact, we have a hard time getting saints to live like saints. Whew. Glory to God. Sin is a heart issue. You can't fix men from the outside. You can just fix them from the inside. When I worked in the prison system for some 21 years, do you know I couldn't change those guys, and the system of the world couldn't change those guys. But I did teach them how they can be changed. And the change comes from the inside out. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Ephesians 5, even when we were dead in sin, has quickened us together with Christ. By grace are you saved. By grace. Grace is not God's ability to overlook our sin. It is the ability He gives us to live above sin. Grace is the power that brings change. Ephesians 2:6. He has raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places. Where? In Christ Jesus. Praise the Lord. He's raised us up together. You cannot be blessed outside the body. Made to sit together. I never saw that before I started reading this. Boy, where are you going to sit? You going to sit by Christ all by yourself? Oh, no, sir. I'll tell you what. You get together with others, and I'll tell you, together, we'll sit. You'll see it. Your victory depends on the body of Christ. Without developing the us mentality, the church will be forever divided and forever less than what God intended. That's why the devil is constantly seeking to bring division among the church. So God's presence, provision, and power can never be made manifest in us by division. Verse 7 says that the ages to come, He might show the exceeding great riches of His. He might show. God likes to show us off like He did Job in the Old Testament. God said to Satan, "Have you considered my servant Job?" If I were Job, I'd let God to say, "Thanks so very much." But that's the way it is. Hallelujah. God likes to show us off. When Jesus told the man laying by the pool of Siloam, when He told the man, "Take up your bed and walk," do you know He says that to you? He wants you to show the world that you are now able to carry once what was once you carried. He wants you to talk about your testimony. In the ages of eternity, God will say, "Look how much I did with so little." Glory to God. By grace are you saved through what? Through faith. And it is not of yourself. It is a gift of God, lest any man should boast. By grace, through faith, it is a gift, not of works. That means God did it. Turn to your neighbor and say, "God did it." So, God did it. But we need to walk in it. God did it. Say it with me. God did it. So we need to walk in it. Hallelujah. West, who is a New Testament translator, said, "By grace have you been saved completely in the past time, with the present result that you are in a state of salvation which persists through the present time." Salvation is the most solid word in the Bible. And recovery from depression and disappointment is possible for everyone, because it even includes, salvation includes our healing. Verse 15 says, "Having abolished in the flesh the enmity." He abolished the war or the strife. That's what enmity was. This means He abolished the strife or the war, even the law of commandments contained in ordinances, to make in Himself twain, or can I say it, two, from one new man, so making peace. There was a division. There was Jew and there was Gentile. And in Acts, The problems that they had and the disputes they had was because the Jews thought they had a hold on the whole thing, but God was pouring out His Spirit on the Gentiles. But 16, verse 16 says, together as one body, Christ reconciled both groups to God by means of His death on the cross, and our hostility toward each other was put to death. You say, that is all included in salvation? Yes. Yes, we need to be concerned what's going on in Israel. We don't realize it, but we've been grafted and put together. Glory to God. Ephesians 2:16, together as one body, Christ reconciled both groups to God by means of His death on the cross, and our hostility toward each other was put to death. Verse 17, and came and preached to you who were far off to lead them nigh. In other words, He brought this good news of peace to you Gentiles who were far away. You were far away from Him, and peace to the Jews who were already there. Wow. So, we have a picture, if you will, of what Christ has done for us on the cross of Calvary. Of Hebrews chapter 4, verse 15 and 16, for we have a high priest which cannot be touched with the feelings of our infirmities, but in all points tempted, like as we were, yet without sin. So let us come boldly unto the throne of grace, where we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in a time of need. Let your conversation, Hebrews 13, 5 and 6, let your conversation be without covetousness, and be content with such things as you have. For He said, I will never leave you nor forsake you, so that we may boldly say, the Lord is my helper. I will not fear what men can do to me. You say, Pastor, what are you saying? I'm saying the promise of God that Paul was talking and writing about to the Ephesians. The promise is to Jew and to Gentile. We, both groups, made into one new man, have access together. We have a royal audience with God at any time. So, Ephesians 2:19. Now, therefore, you are no more strangers and foreigners, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and of the household of God. Where do you live? In the household of God. What are you doing? Standing outside, ringing the bell. When Jesus died to give you the key, there is a fight, but the fight's been already won. And now we together, we fight the fight of faith. Timothy chapter 6, verse 12 says, fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold on eternal life, to which you were also called and have confessed the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. When you come to Christ, it should not be a silent deal. You need, the moment you come to Christ, you need to tell somebody about it. And those of you that have known Christ so very long, you need to tell Christ, or to tell people about what Christ has done in your life. It is an ongoing story. It never stops. Old or young, we have the Holy Spirit, which was given so that we would be witnesses. It's not a one-time happening. It is a living. So Ephesians 2:20 says, we are built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets. Christ himself being the chief cornerstone. We are built on the foundation of what the apostles and the prophets said. We are built on a cornerstone of what Jesus did. Praise God. Verse 21, in whom all the building. What is the building? Well, it's Jew and Gentile that knows and serves Jesus. We're all built together. Nobody left out. There's neither Jew nor Greek, nor white or black or yellow or green. We are all fitted. Glory to God. We all fit. We are fitly framed together. We cannot be independent. You cannot be independent and be a part of the body of Christ because you are framed together. You need to be growing. And as you are growing, others around you grow. Now, I get it. I'm not talking about if you don't belong. I'm not saying if you can only be along a part of the body of Christ if you are a member of the church. I'm not saying that. Because I know too well, I'm working with them. People from all kinds of denominations and faith backgrounds. They are fitted together. When you know Jesus, they are fitted together. Verse 22 says, you are built together for a habitation of God through the Spirit. You are built together. Satan's only hope of overthrowing our faith is creating disunity. You know, I haven't seen demons fighting together because usually they are united. The world has unity too. You only have to look at what was happening with the Tower of Babel back in the early days. God said, hey, if we leave them alone, nothing will be impossible to them. In fact, in Acts 2, talks about believers being in one accord. That word accord in the New Testament is homothumadon. Turn to your neighbor and tell them that word, homothumadon. It means in one accord. But I have to tell you, the world has homothumadon too. It's actually found in Acts when Stephen the martyr when they heard what Stephen told them, Bible says they were cut to the heart and they gnashed at him with their teeth. But he, being full of the Holy Spirit, gazed into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing there at the right hand and said, look, I see the heavens open and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God. That's what he was crying as he was being stoned. When I say he's being stoned, he wasn't on drugs. They had stones. They had actual stones and they were throwing the stones at him. But when these people heard, when they heard what he said, the Bible says they cried out with a loud voice. They stopped their ears and ran at him with one accord. Exact same word. So unbelievers can have unity, but their unity is usually against God. They know, divide and conquer. Now the church of Jesus, which is now the body of Jesus on earth. When I put it like that, now you can understand when I say you cannot love Christ without loving his body. You cannot love Christ and not love the church. Now, I don't like religion and all that stuff. I get it. But I recognize the body of Christ. And I recognize the church. John chapter 17, verse 20, I'm almost through. He said, I pray for them which shall believe on me through their word, that they all may be one, as thou, Father, art in me and I in you, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that you have sent me. The power of sin, the penalty of sin, the presence of sin is all around us. But how do I get through it? Ephesians 2:10 says, we are his workmanship created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God has ordained before we should walk in them. We are his workmanship. Why don't you turn to your neighbor? I can see God working on you. Why is he working on you? Because you are his workmanship. And if you don't know Jesus, you just don't recognize right now that he is working on you. Well, God is working to the outside, but he's deposited something on the inside. And what he has deposited inside was created to do good works for him, that we should walk in them, that we should order our lives within the sphere of the works that God has designed for us. Verse 11, remember that you being in times past Gentiles in the flesh, who are now called uncircumcised, so that which is called circumcision in the flesh, which is made by hands. It says, remember, he's talking about what he's saying there. Look back with appreciation of what God has done for you. When you look back, if you're going through trouble, look back and see what God has done in your life, and you'll get a pick-me-up. Glory to God. For verse 14, he is our peace, who has made both one, broken down walls, the middle walls of between us. He is our peace. Christ not only gives peace, but he, and by the way, it can be temporary, but he desires that you have a permanent peace. Glory to God. So where are you today? Are you separated from God? Do you separate or are you living apart from the body of Christ? Are you in place to be a part of the habitation of God? Are you walking in harmony into the course of this world according to the prince and power of the air? Or are you walking with God's word? And are you in step with others in the army of God? Are you working for the blessings of God? Or do you realize that the blessings are a finished work? Are you possessing them? You do have to fight for them. It's the fight of faith which is our challenge. Let me say it again. The enemy wants to define you by your scars. But Jesus wants to define you by his scars and to step in to the blessings that he has for you, and that includes salvation. I don't believe in eternal security like some do. They feel like they can just live life the way they can just say a little prayer and live life the way that they want. But the Bible doesn't teach me that. There is a security in God. And that security only comes from my staying in the plan of God. As long as I stand and work, and if I plant myself in his word, and if I plant myself in his presence, yes, I am secure. That's one of the reasons why. And then in the Bible says in the last days there'll be a great falling away. Be a great falling away. They don't need to fall away. So, where are you in your walk, in your living? Little song comes to mind. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. The cross before me, the world behind me. The cross before me, the world behind me. The cross before me, the world behind me. No turning back, no turning back. You have to make a decision whether you are going to decide to follow Jesus and go after his plan for you and to live life according to his plan. You decide. And you know, really, we could say a prayer, but you have to make a decision. You decide. And you may be here or watching online and you go, wow, it's just a decision? Yes. And if you make that decision, if you've never made that decision before, can I see your hand? You've never made that decision to follow Jesus. I'm not going to embarrass you. You've never made that decision to follow Jesus. Once you've made that decision, no turning back. Boy, you'll find out that there's abundant life for you. Thank you, Jesus. And it could be that you were a little shy and you want to talk to me about a decision to follow Jesus. You can do that at a later time. You can call us up if you're online. Father in heaven, I thank you for this opportunity that we have right now. In your word, you have shared through Paul the Apostle all that we have in Christ Jesus. I pray for those that have never made that decision to follow you. I ask, Lord, that even throughout this day, they'll be faced with the question, am I going to make that decision? Am I going to make that decision? Give them the strength, Lord, and the insight and the freedom. I take authority over the blinding veil of darkness that lays over eyes. I unstop the ears of those don't want to hear it, like those that were stoning Stephen. In Jesus' name, soften hearts, even this day, to make a decision to follow you. No turning back. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you.